District 9. So our next panel is going to be all about that. And I want to assure everyone here that we have screened out the non-humans. And they are now currently in the Comic-Con detention camp, so we're all safe.
Yeah.
Producer of the film. Well, you probably know some of his credits. Director
awesome.
Of Bad Taste, Meet the Feebles, Brain Dead, Heavenly Creatures, Forgotten Silver, The Frighteners, Lord of the Rings, Two Towers, Return of the King, King Kong, The Lovely Bones. He's got a bag full of Oscars, but one of his favorite honors is being crowned the Geek God by the New York Times. Please help me welcome a remarkable filmmaker, Mr. Peter Jackson.
Thank you very much. Thank you. It's so much better being here than being a talking head on a screen, because I get to see you guys, which is fantastic. All this geek power. I wish you could just take the amount of energy and bottle it and then give it to Hollywood executives to drink. It'd be good. I'm obviously here to introduce District 9, a film I'm very, very proud of. But just before I get underway with that, I know that you're probably going to have a lot of questions about The Hobbit. Like, you're probably going to want to know that, you know, Bilbo Baggins is going to be played by... and I think he's going to be really good. No, I just thought before we get going with District 9, I'd give you a little bit of an update on The Hobbit. We're about, because everything's a process, it's a pipeline, and we're about 3 or 4 weeks away from delivering our first draft of the script of the first movie to Warner Brothers. Because the film's not green lit yet. You know, we have to submit a script, the studio have to read the script and like it, and then once we have a script, we can then do a budget, and we have to figure out how much the films are going to cost, and the studio have to then agree and green light the movie. So it's a process that we haven't really even got to the point that we're green lit yet. So if any of you want to see The Hobbit, you know, you could drop Warner Brothers a line and encourage them to be kind to us. But I know that there's a lot of speculation about casting and who's playing different roles, and I just want to be able to say, because it may avoid some of the questions later on, that, you know, we haven't got to the stage that we can offer anybody a role yet, because obviously we have to be green lit. We have to have the authority to be able to make offers to actors, that we have to be able to give them a schedule of when we want them to work and how long they need to work for. And obviously, actors are going to want to read a script, so we have to have a script ready for them. So we're still about 3 or 4 weeks away from delivering that draft, and then we can start the process of the budget, and eventually, probably in about 2 months, is when we're going to be able to actually start to offer people roles. So despite everything you might have read and all the gossip and everything else, they literally, honestly, have not offered anybody a role in the film at this stage. We are doing 2 movies, just to clarify that The Hobbit, because one of the things which is interesting is, as you know, obviously Tolkien wrote The Hobbit first in 1936, and then about 20 years later he published Lord of the Rings, and he had expanded and developed the world of Middle-earth way bigger and larger and more detailed than he knew about when he wrote The Hobbit. And he did a lot of retrospective detailing. So the Lord of the Rings, the novel, contains a lot of information about what was happening during the years of The Hobbit and events that were happening outside of that particular storyline, but, you know, things that were happening behind the scenes in Middle-earth and the geopolitics and things. And so Tolkien never got to combine that together in one book. But one of the things we were really excited about when we got to be thinking about it is we can take that expanded information that he developed later on, and we can apply it to The Hobbit and sort of make it fuller and more epic, and sort of really put The Hobbit in the context of the greater activity that's happening in Middle Earth at that time. So to do all that, and to we figured that we really need two epic films to be able to really tell that story.